Have you ever been betrayed by a close friend or a family member? As someone that you trusted betrayed you, turned their back on you, maybe left you? Can you remember the hurt and the pain that that caused? The sorrow that you felt? I want us to think about this morning of Jesus on the cross. As Jesus is becoming our sin. It tells us in Romans that he who knew no sin became sin for us. And so as Jesus became our sin, it altered the relationship that he had had with his Father from the beginning of time. There is an event on the cross that is different from any other recorded event in history. And we see that as recorded by Matthew in chapter 27, as we continue to go through the seven last words of Christ from the cross. In chapter 27, beginning in verse 45, from noon till 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over the whole land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why hast you forsaken me?" Imagine the anguish that Jesus feels as his Father forsakes him, as his Father turns his back on him, as his Father must punish him with the full wrath of the sins that have been committed so that you and I could be saved. Jesus Christ, for the only time in history, eternity past to eternity future, separated, forsaken by his Father for us. Jesus loved us so much that he was willing to go to the cross. God loved us so much that he was willing to forsake his Son, who became sin on our behalf to pay the punishment for the sins that we commit, that we might have a relationship with him. And as we think about Jesus being forsaken on the cross, as we think about the sacrifice that he made, I want us to think about what it is that we can learn from that and how it is that we can apply what Jesus did. And so there's a lot of passages we could turn to, but this morning we're going to look at 1 Peter chapter 2. And as we're looking at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21 is where we'll start. It sets in an interesting place. It's not unusual. We see in Ephesians and Colossians where we have this idea of how husbands and wives are supposed to treat each other, and children and parents, and slaves to masters. Paul writes about that both in Colossians and Ephesians. But we also see it here in Peter. But the difference is, Peter starts with this idea of slaves and masters. And then we read the passage we're going to look at today. And then he goes to the idea of the relationship between a husband and a wife. And so in between those relationships of how we're supposed to love the other and submit to the other and surrender to the other and all those things that we're supposed to do, Peter has these words, writes these words. God's word says in 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning verse 21, "For you are called to this, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow his steps. He did not commit sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he was suffering, he did not threaten, but entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that having died to sins, we might live for righteousness. You have been healed by his wounds. For you were like sheep going astray, but you have now returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls." Let's unite our hearts in prayer. Dear God, we again praise you as God. We praise you for your majesty and your beauty. We praise you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. We thank you that your Holy Spirit inspired Peter to write these words, and that we have access to them. So Lord, I pray that you'll take your truth of your word, use it to penetrate our hearts, and that we might indeed know more about you, draw closer to you, love you even more, and serve you in a greater way through the power of your Holy Spirit. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Our theme comes from the first verse. God calls us to live a life of forsaking ourselves. God calls us to live a life of forsaking ourselves. Verse 21, for you were called to this. We are called to salvation. There is no work that we can do. There is nothing that I can ever do on my own to be saved. I can't earn it. I can't work for it. There's not enough goodness that I can do that can save me. I am called by the Holy Spirit of God to receive the salvation that He provides. God sent His Son to die on a cross for us. We are called to this. We're called to this life because Christ suffered for you, for us, leaving us an example that we might follow in His footsteps. Salvation comes when our life is completely changed by the power of the Holy Spirit. God approaches us through the power of His Holy Spirit. We respond to that by believing that Christ died and rose again. We believe that as He died, that He paid the price of our sins. That as He rose from the dead physically, it demonstrates that we also can be resurrected and be with Christ forever. And God demands that we surrender to Him. God demands that we give Him our whole life. We can read in Scripture in multiple places where it says we need to count the cost. No builder builds a building without first seeing how much it's going to cost. We are to count the cost of being a Christian. There's a price. It comes free as far as monetary cost. But it comes with a surrender of our life to give the Lord the best that we have, all that we have, and allow everything in our life to come under His authority. We have been called to this. And then Jesus gives us an example. And so we're going to look at the example that Jesus gave and what it is that we can learn from that. So what can we learn? Well, first of all, we're going to see lessons learned from the cross. We're going to see lessons learned from the cross. The first lesson we learn is to hold our tongue. Hold our tongue. Verse 22. He did not commit sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. Now, if you have a Holman Christian Bible like mine, those words are in bold to remind us that this is coming from quoting an Old Testament passage. Now, what Peter does throughout this passage is he goes to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 is the passage known as the suffering servant. Surely that's another good one for your Bible right there. Isaiah 53 is the suffering servant. It lets us know why Jesus Christ died on the cross, that he bore our sins. It's interesting, if you remember, we did a Passover Seder service a couple years ago and had someone from Chosen People's Ministry come. And when he came, he told us that growing up as a Jew, they never really paid attention. They're reading through the Hebrew Bible, never really addressed Isaiah 53. It wasn't part of their common reading. But it was reading Isaiah 53 that he understood why Jesus came and why Jesus was the Messiah. See, we know that the Israelites at the time of Jesus were looking for who to be a savior. They were looking for a military king, someone that could defeat the Romans, somebody that could lift them back up militarily. Well, what does Isaiah 53 tell us about the servant of God, the Messiah? That he was going to die. That he would remain silent as the sheep before his shears, as he was killed. That he would die for our transgressions. That he was a man of sorrows and took on the burden of our price. See, it's not a Messiah of a victory here on earth. It's a Messiah that was willingly slain so that we could receive salvation. He stood silent as there were lies about him. He stood lies as they broke their laws, of even about how to have trials that would lead to his death. He stood silent as even Pilate recognized he had done no wrong and decided for political purpose he was allowed Jesus to be crucified anyway. Jesus held his tongue and didn't say a word. about his accusers. Jesus said only what God encouraged him to say, and we see very few recorded words of Jesus from the time that he's accused until the time he's on the cross. And so we're reminded that one of the ways that we demonstrate our love of God is by how we speak. Our mouths can do a lot of good. We proclaim the gospel. Every Christian is to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are to tell others what Jesus has done. We use our mouth to sing praises to God. There's a lot of good things that we can do with our mouths. We can build each other up. But as James reminds us, out of the same mouth that springs forth good should not spring forth bad. Just like a good spring of water is not going to produce bad water. We need to make sure that as we speak, that we build. There are times that we're better off just not saying a word. There are times where silence is the best answer. There are times that when we speak, we hurt people with what we say, with how we say it. We can do a lot of damage to the body of Christ. We can do a lot of damage to our witness in just a moment with what we say and how we address someone. I was leading a youth Wednesday night Bible study for our youth leader while I was in Christiansburg at Main Street Baptist Church, and we were meeting at this place called Straight Street. And I had decided that what I was going to do for my opening, I was going to talk about the tongue that night and about speaking. I decided what I would do for my opening illustration is I would hit my Bible against the bottom of my leg and let it drop. And I would say just a small cuss word, a cuss word that most people wouldn't even consider, a lot of people wouldn't even consider a cuss word today. So I did that. And I just held my head down for about 5 or 10 seconds. And it was amazing to hear the discussion among the youth about what had just happened. Did he really say that? And after about 5 or 10 seconds, I looked up and I said, I just want to ask you, how many of y'all lost respect for me in that 1 second? And about half the kids and most of the solid ones said, yeah, I really did, just a little bit. Now, when they found out I was playing, they forgave me. But it's interesting, just really quickly, how quick we can lose our testimony. How quick we can divide. Our tongue can be used for goodness, but it also can be used for slander, malice, gossip, talk about people instead of to people. I will tell you, I'm amazed at pastors, some of the stuff that gets back to me that people say about me. I would encourage you that when you have a problem with anyone in this church, including the pastor, that you should go directly to them. I'll never forget my first Memorial Day here. We didn't do anything in the Memorial Day service to recognize that it was Memorial Day. I had someone call me, it was either Monday morning or Tuesday morning. Said, by the way, it's Memorial Day, why didn't you do anything? We've recognized Memorial Day ever since. But I've always appreciated that person called me instead of running to their neighbors and talking about it. And that's how we should be. We are to build up the body because our tongue can divide. Our tongue can create great damage within the body. It creates damage outside the body. How we speak, the attitude that we have that's demonstrated by our speech has an impact. If I'm mean, if I'm harsh, no one's going to care if I share the gospel. No one's going to care what I have to say. Our tongues, our mouths can be used for great things. But we have to tame our tongue. We have to make sure that we keep it under control. I love what James writes. James, if you remember, was the first pastor. He's a half-brother of Jesus Christ. And as he's talking about this, one of the areas he talks about this in his letter, he says this in chapter 3, beginning in verse 3. And he's a pastor, so he gives a couple of illustrations. Now, when we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we also guide the whole animal. just a little bit, and you can direct a horse anywhere it goes. Also consider ships, though very large and driven by fierce wind, they're guided by a very small rudder wherever the pilot directs. Again, something big and powerful, and yet something small that controls it. So too, though the tongue is a small part of the body, it boasts great things. Consider how a large forest fire starts with something small. It can be ignited by something little. Our tongues make a difference. If we are going to follow the example of Jesus on the cross, if we are going to learn to model Jesus Christ, we must hold our tongue. We must hold our temper. We must hold our temper. When he is reviled, he did not revile in return. When he was mocked, when he was beaten, when he was spat on, when he was scorned, when he was scourged, when he was hung on a cross, Jesus never responded. He had prayed the night before. It says that he was almost sorrowful to the point of death. He bled as sweats of drops of blood because of the anguish of what he knew was ahead. And yet through it all, he was able to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit as a man, being tempted in every way that we're tempted, and never retaliate. What's normally the first thing we want to do when someone says something against us or does something against us? We want to lash out. We want to respond. We want to retaliate. We want to justify ourselves. Jesus Christ is being forsaken by the Father on the cross, and yet never says a word and holds his temper. He cries out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? But all the time mentally understanding that God forsook him because he was bearing the sins that we've committed and are going to commit. And of all those that have committed sins, Jesus Christ was the one that took on all of our sins and never said a word. When he was reviled, he never reviled them. He didn't respond. And I think a lot of times we like to get revenge. Have you ever had somebody that you worked with, or maybe even a family member, somebody in the neighborhood, or just somebody that you know, that you really just didn't like a whole lot? I mean, be honest, we got those. Now the question is this: do I wish evil on that person? Do I hide in my heart the idea of revenge, even if it takes a long time, so that I can hurt somebody? That I can see them suffer. They'll pay for that one day. And we want to take justice into our own hands. Now, when Barbara and I got married, Gary Poitras, Gary that comes here and sings some, we made a deal. And this was the deal. On the day that I get married, Gary is going to let me hide the car that we're going to take out of town before we headed down to Charleston, South Carolina for our honeymoon. We were going to hide that car because we know the car at the church is going to get messed up. And then Gary is going to clean the car and take it back to the house, have the key there waiting for us when we get back from our honeymoon. And in return, I was going to do the same thing for Gary. I was going to hide his car, his good car, so that they could take off, and then I was going to clean up the car that kind of got trashed at the church. So Gary does that. We come home, the key's on the kitchen table, along with toilet paper everywhere in the house. And it said Gary was here. Now, I decided in the moment I was never going to acknowledge it. I wasn't going to say a word to Gary. I wasn't going to let him know I paid attention. I was going to wait until he got married. And then I would get my revenge. Now, I had to wait a long time. My younger daughter, Madeline, was a flower girl in his wedding. 10 to 11 years later, I only had one issue. Gary was renting a small house on a farm, and I had to get in the house. Now, the mistake I made, well, I didn't find out until later, one of his landlord was actually one of the groomsmen, and he was all about me trashing the house as long as I didn't do any permanent damage, and I didn't know that till it was too late, or would ask him for a key to get inside. And unfortunately, I asked one of Gary's sisters. She has two sisters. She is now referred to as the evil sister, because she told Gary what I was going to do. And as they were getting ready to leave, Dawn just looked at me and she goes, "Be nice." And I was like, "Dad, Vernon, I can't stand your sister." And because I knew where she'd found out from. Because that was the only person, in, I mean, 11 years, Barbara had never heard me talk about it. Nobody knew what I had in mind for 11 years. And then it was ruined at the last thing. Now, that's just fun. And that's playful, and there's nothing serious about that. And Gary, you know, I love Gary. It really wasn't even hostility. It was just going to be. And Gary, by the way, just in Gary's defense, he swears it was not him. He swears it wasn't him. Who knows? But the point is this. How often is it that we do that to people on stuff that matters, on stuff we care about, that we harbor ill will? How often is it that we lose our temper? I've found, because I've always fought a temper. And so when I feel like I'm losing my temper, I always go back and think, why did I get so mad? And this is what I have found, and I don't think I'm that different from most people. That if I'll go back and look at any time I got mad, that 99.99% of the time it's not justified. And it's because I have too big an ego. And my feelings were hurt. And what caused me to be angry really is not that big a deal in the grand scheme of life. And a demonstration of love and patience is much more important than how my feelings might have gotten hurt, or how I thought you might not do the right thing, or how gracious would somebody offend me. It's important that we hold our temper. When I went to Asia, to Nepal, on our mission trip, they told us before we went that the worst thing that we could do on the trip was to lose our temper, because basically it would ruin the testimony of the entire team. Because in Asian culture, losing your temper is just completely out of acceptability. Now, Paul writes this in Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 25. Since you put away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. Now, I put that in there because that's, it's just interesting. The order of this is similar to the order we're reading in Peter, that first you talk about the tongue. We put away lying, speak truth. Then it says this in verse 26, be angry, do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. So if we get angry, don't let it be a sin. Make sure we don't act in a way that's sinful. It's not saying that we're not going to feel that. It's how do we demonstrate that? It's like Job. Job, you could tell, was frustrated with God. I'm righteous. Why is this happening to me? This shouldn't happen to me. God, I demand a hearing. I am worthy of a hearing. Now, God finally appears and says, hey, Job, who are you? Where were you when the world was created? But it tells us in all the frustration that we see from Job that he never sinned. And so we feel that burst of anger. We have to control it. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Don't hold hostility. Don't revile someone that's reviled you. See, here's the thing. God forsake his son so that we are never forsaken. It tells us that in Hebrews 13:5, that God will never leave us nor forsake us. Jesus was forsaken so that God will always be with us. Hold our tongue. Hold our temper. Finally, a lesson learned from the cross is hold our trust. Hold our trust. When he was suffering. Now, it's interesting. I want to address this before we finish the verse. When we look at the context that this is written in, literary context, what's going on in the book of Peter, he's already told Christians before this that we're going to suffer. That we're going to suffer for the cause of Christ. If we are doing what we are supposed to do, it may not be a physical suffering, but there are consequences to following Christ in this world, because this world is against Christ and God. All right? So he's already said that we're going to suffer. He's not telling us here we're going to suffer, but it's more how to handle it. When he was suffering, he did not threaten. Think about that. He didn't threaten. Can you imagine the threats that Jesus could have made? Dude, you're going to burn in hell for eternity. Ha! Imagine what's coming for you. But he didn't make threats. In fact, we talked last week. He said, "My God," he asked God to forgive them. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." When suffering, he didn't threaten, but entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. Judges. Trust the one that judges justly. And we understand that there's a lot of times we won't see justice in this world. That it will only come about when Christ returns. We won't genuinely understand justice until Jesus has come back and we see God judge. And so sometimes we have to just be patient. You can read in Scripture where it says that when someone turns on you, that if you pray for them, it's just heaping coals of burning fire on them. That's how you get justice. You treat them good, you ask God to forgive them, and then as they reject him, that's ultimately where the judgment comes. But we are, the way Christ did when he was punished, not to respond and to trust God the long term. And the way we do that is we wait for the big, we have a view of the big picture. That our view is not minute by minute, day by day, but it's a view of eternity. And how does my actions in this moment benefit the big picture of glorifying God? How do my actions in this moment, when I'm suffering, when I've been wronged, when I've been offended, how is it in the big picture, when the last judgment comes, as God is glorified, can his glory be seen in my life? How is it that I can look at the world constantly waiting for the day that Jesus returns to administer justice? It is to make sure that we work short term, holding our tongue, holding our temper, holding our trust in God, and we don't rebel against him. Now Rocky Marciano was a great boxer, retired, undefeated. Heavyweight champion of the world, 49-0. Known for how hard he punched. And so people would cover up at the beginning of the fight to try to protect themselves from the ferocity of his punches. And when they talked to Rocky Marciano one time, he said, "Yeah," he goes, "early in a fight, a lot of times, I just aim for their arms. Because I know that the harder I can hit their arms, that before the fight ends, those arms are going to drop. And then that's going to open up for me to lay a knockout blow later. Looking at the end result, how do I get there?" That's how we need to be with God. We need to make sure that our trust is in the end result, in not trying to seek what we think is justice every single day. Because God's view is much greater and much broader than ours can ever be. If we want to follow the example of Jesus, what we can learn to do is to look and hold on to our faith. The writer of Hebrews says this, Hebrews chapter 4, beginning in verse 14, "Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast, let us cling to our confession." Paul writes in Galatians 2:20, "I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. It is Christ that lives in me. The life I live in this body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." That's our confession. "I've been crucified with Christ." Hold to our confession. "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But one who has been tested in every way as we are, yet without sin." See, here's the deal. I don't face a temptation by which Christ does not also face a similar temptation when he was here. Yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us at the proper time. Let us go to the Lord in prayer continually and daily that we may find grace and mercy at the proper time so that we too can extend grace and mercy. Lessons learned from the cross. Hold our tongue. Hold our temple. Hold our trust. In addition to the lessons we learned at the cross, when we see Jesus' example, we also see that life's provided from the cross. Life provided from the cross. How is that provided? First of all, righteousness provided. Righteousness provided. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree. Again, Jesus taking on our suffering, our punishment for what we've done, so that having died to sins, when we have died to sins, we live for righteousness. We have been healed, past tense. We live for righteousness, present and future tense. And we've been healed by his wounds in the past. We live for righteousness. Sometimes as Christians, and I believe when we struggle with how we walk and we struggle with how we're living, we like to go, you know, I'm going to clean myself up and then I'll worry about getting right with God. Or I'm going to clean myself up and then I'll be right with God. Let me just tell you something. We can never clean up ourselves. There is nothing we can ever do to cleanse ourselves. It comes from the righteousness that Christ provided on the cross with his death. Think about that, by the way. What in the world can I offer God that is greater than the blood that Jesus Christ offered on the cross? What is it that I could possibly offer God that stands in comparison with that? There's nothing. And that's why Jesus knocks at the door and asks us to come on to him, to know him, to dwell with him. God says, come to me. Draw close to me. Withstand the devil. And we draw close to God, not because of my actions, but because God continues to draw us to us. I think a lot of times we get that mixed up as Christians. We think, okay, yeah, I received salvation because Jesus died on the cross, but now I'm going to do the best I can to live a holy life. Let me tell you something. It's not up to me to live a holy life. Now, don't misquote me on that. Make sure you hear all of that one. It's up to me to surrender to the Holy Spirit that will guide me into a holy life. Because I'm never going to live a holy life on my own. I don't care how much willpower you have. You cannot live without sin, without the power of God. God is the one that imputed the righteousness of Christ in us. Again, when we stand in judgment, it's not just that we stand without sin, we stand with the righteousness of Christ. The Holy Spirit dwells inside of us that we can live with the righteousness of God. We can live in righteousness. God takes away our sins. He makes us completely clean. Now, I tried this when I first got here. In fact, I still have the lamb that Charles made for me and carved out of a bar of ivory soap. I saw a girl named Libby in our youth group do this when we were on a mission trip when I was in high school. And we went up to Pennsylvania. We're doing a VBS, and as with most Bible schools, you do the salvation story on the last day. And she had a big jug of water, and she poured some red food coloring in it, made the water red, couldn't see through it, it was dirty, it was murky. It's like basically that's our sin. You know, it blots you, we're not clear, we're not pure. And then you take you use ivory soap and you soak it in iodine, and when you soak it and you put it in there, if you do it right, mine didn't work here, but if you do it right the way she did it that day and you soak it long enough and it works, the water becomes perfectly clear. It's like nothing ever happened, you can see straight through it. And that's what God does to give us righteousness. He makes us a new creation. We are new beings. We have been changed by the power of God. I don't know that it's written any better anywhere in Scripture than Romans chapter 3. And so I want to read through that real quick. Romans chapter 3, begin in verse 21. But now, apart from the law, God's righteousness has been revealed. So apart from the actual law is written, attested by the law and the prophets. The law and the prophets is a referral to the Hebrew Bible, our Old Testament. So apart from the law, God's righteousness has been revealed as attested by the law and the prophets. That is, God's righteousness through faith in Jesus Christ. Our righteousness comes in faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe, since there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are justified, legal term, meaning we're no longer guilty. Justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. Redemption marketplace term, talking of buying something. And so it's buying our freedom, paid the price for our freedom, the way a slave would have had their freedom paid for in their culture. So we're justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is brought in Jesus Christ. God presented him as a propitiation through faith in his blood. Propitiation means it appeases the wrath of God. The wrath of God on my sins is appeased through faith in his blood to demonstrate his righteousness. Because in his restraint, God passed over the sins previously committed. God presented him, Jesus, to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so that he would be righteous and declare righteous the one who has faith in Jesus, so that we can be declared righteous and be righteous through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the righteousness that is provided with the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. Not only is righteousness provided, restoration is provided. Restoration is provided. Look with me at verse 25. You were like sheep going astray. Sheep. Now remember what sheep, we're sheep. Dumb, can't see, don't have any way to protect ourselves. That's just who sheep are. That's us. And sheep go astray. Just can't see. That's why sheep, if you go to the end of a cliff, they'll just keep following each other. Because they can't see well enough to know the person in front of them just died going off a cliff, so they just keep going. We're like sheep going astray. We wander off. We don't know where we're going. But you've now been returned to the shepherd and the guardian of your soul. We've been returned from the cliff. Sheep will walk into a fire. Can you imagine that? Just walking into a fire and burning up and dying. That's sheep. But we've been returned to the shepherd, the guardian of our soul. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me beside the still waters and the green pastures. Yea, though I walk through the valley of death, he is there with me. That's the result of being restored. That's a result of the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. That's the result of what God has done and not us. And I just want to tell you, I don't care what sin you've committed. I don't care what you've done wrong. God can forgive us and will forgive us when we genuinely seek him. Now, I'm going to go back to 2 Chronicles 33. I want to read about a king named Manasseh. I'm going to read selected verses just to give us an appreciation for who Manasseh was. And I understand salvation for Manasseh would have been different for us, but we'll see. We'll see sin, we'll see a calling to God, and we'll see a life that's changed. That, by the way, is every Christian's testimony. What I was like before I sinned, when I got saved, and what God's done for me since. And we're going to look at that with Manasseh. Chapter 33, verse 1, Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. So he reigned a long time. Verse 7. Manasseh set up a carved image of the idol he had made in God's temple. Manasseh set up an idol that he made in the temple of God. On list of sins, let me just tell you, that one ranks pretty high. Make no graven image, and sure, don't put it in some place that represents God's presence. Skip down to verse 9. So Manasseh caused Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to stray, so that they did worse evil than the nations the Lord had destroyed before the Israelites. Now I want to put that in perspective. When people ask, why is it they went in and destroyed all the Canaanite women and children and the men and destroyed everything when they went in, it was a punishment for the evil of the lives that they were living, including the fact that they would burn their children as sacrifices. So understand that the Canaanites that were run out of the promised land burned their children as sacrifices. He led Jerusalem to stray so that they did worse evil than the nations the Lord had destroyed before the Israelites. That's not good.
The Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they didn't listen. So this was the consequence. He brought against them the military commanders of the king of Assyria. They captured Manasseh with hooks, bound him with bronze shackles, and took him to Babylon. I cringe every time I read that. Hooks. When he was in distress, he sought the favor of Yahweh his God and earnestly humbled himself before the God of his ancestors. Genuine repentance, not godly sorrow which leads to destruction, not worldly sorrow which leads to destruction, but godly sorrow, a true change of who he was. He prayed to God. So God heard his petition and granted his request and brought him back to Jerusalem, to his kingdom. So Manasseh came to know Yahweh, his God. Now this wasn't just because he was in distress. It's genuine. His life changed. We'll skip down to verse 15. He removed the foreign gods and the idols from the Lord's temple, and along with all the altars that he had built on the mountain of the Lord's temple and in Jerusalem, and he threw them outside the city. He built the altar of the Lord and offered fellowship and thank offerings on it. Then he told Judah to serve Yahweh, the God of Israel. Manasseh, the most evil of all the kings, and God forgave him when he cried out to him. And he led Israel back to worshiping God and tore down the idols that he had made. That's restoration. That's being restored in fellowship with God. That's what happens on the cross with Jesus Christ. We're restored. God gives us righteousness. God restores us. So what do we learn from the lesson of Jesus? Hold our tongues. Hold our temper. Hold our trust. Why? Because you have been called to this. Because Christ died for us. Bow your heads with me. How is it God wants me to respond this morning? That's the question we always all want to be sensitive to right now. Is it for salvation? Am I genuinely changed by the power of God? I have the righteousness of Christ. I've been restored. Or this morning, do I feel God calling me? Calling, O sinner, come home. Maybe this morning you need to come down and talk to me during our invitation hymn. Maybe you need to speak with me after the service. But maybe this morning you just need to talk to me or someone else about being genuinely saved. Like Manasseh, when he was sincere, when he prayed to God. Not just to relent destruction, but to be restored and to have righteousness. If I'm a believer, maybe I need to pray for God to forgive me and help me to control my tongue. That I'll remain silent when I need to remain silent. That I will speak in a way that lifts up and doesn't tear down. Not gossip, not slander, but allow only good water to proceed from my mouth for the glory of God. Maybe this morning I need to pray about forgiveness for my temper. Maybe there's an individual that I need to go and apologize to because I've wronged them when I got upset. Maybe there's someone I've held bitter feelings to for weeks, months, or years. Today, I need to restore that relationship by giving them forgiveness or seeking forgiveness if I've wronged someone.
Maybe as we gather this morning, our faith is shaken. We've suffered. We're hurting. And we know that this morning, the only thing that we can cling to is faith that the just God will act in the end. That He will, as He promises us, never leave us nor forsake us, because He forsake His Son for us. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, as You call us, give us the power to respond, that You might receive all the glory. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.